Good day, ladies and gentlemen. And today I want to discuss Jane Cochrane's Audacious Island. How do we even describe this book? It's an autobiographical piece or a memoir, so to speak. It's a memoir and it's also an archaeological piece, because in the book majorly is focused on the discovery of Odysseus's palace, right? The book is focused on the discovery of Odysseus's palace. I was fascinated with this book when I picked it, because of my background in literature. Actually, I came across Homer's epic poem, the Iliad, and even Odysseus. The Odyssey and the Iliad, both epic poems. I came across them while I was still a fresh student out of the high school then, when I first read those epic poems, although it was kind of simplified or watered down. It was not it was in prose form actually, but I did enjoy the poems, and it heightened my interest in Greek literature. A few years after that, I came across the movie, the titled Troy, which has to do with the Iliad also, which is the story of what happened the 10 years Greek war that took place over Helene. So I was fascinated with the book when I saw it, because as at the time I picked the book, I had watched a documentary about the discovery of Troy in modern-day Turkey. And even before that, there was something that happened, a particular thing that happened while I was still an undergraduate. I was in class arguing with my professor then, and we were talking about how literature is born out of actual life experiences. And he was of the Marxist orientation. I mean, it was of the formalist orientation, and he wanted us to look at the text as an entity on its own without having external link. But I was insistent. I couldn't understand where he was coming from then. So I was insistent on looking at the text as it relates to life, that there is something that text has to tell us about lives of real individuals, about real events and occurrences in our own human sphere. But he said it has to be about the text only. So I brought up an example and told him that, for instance, now when Homer's epic when people discovered Homer's epic and were written, none of them could have believed that the events described in those epic poems actually have a relation to real life. Some of them believe that it was mere fiction, until it was discovered that yes, a place like Troy actually existed in the past. But he said no, that I knew nothing, there is nothing like Troy existing anywhere, that the Troy that you can talk about, the Iliad, can only exist in Homer's epic, nothing outside of that. So when I left school several years after, I actually watched the documentary. Then I read about the discovery, and now I watch the documentary. And you know, I think it was discovered by Heinrich Schliemann, a German businessman, an archaeologist, an amateur archaeologist, who discovered the site of Troy initially. And you know, with that discovery, it has pushed many people to also move, to also presume that the other places mentioned in the epic and some of those classical texts could have existed in real life. You know, we wanted to know where Odysseus' palace may have been. And you know, after that, the palaces of Agamemnon and Nestor were discovered. So it means that there's a correlation between fiction and actual life, that this events actually took place. It may not have been of the same propensity as what is described. Omar may have exaggerated here and there, as it is with literary writers that don't have the rule a rule that states that they have to maintain everything word for word, or that stick to the actual way events happen. You know, a little bit of sprinkling may have happened here and there, but it doesn't differ from the fact that these things actually occurred at a time in the past. So when I saw Odysseus's Island, I was interested in picking up the book because I wanted to know if it has also been discovered too. You know, today people are going around looking for Atlantis. It was first mentioned in Plato's The Republic. And with that, people believe that Plato couldn't have just been, it all couldn't have been fiction. There must have been something like that. And, you know, some people have been able to locate it somewhere close to Spain. And I've seen documentary of some people saying that it is located at a place called the Eye of the Sahara Desert, somewhere in Africa. You know, so these are speculations yet, and we're not sure if it actually existed or not. But that of so far from the evidence is on from the evidence on ground, it is certain that Homer's epic, the stories told in Homer's epic, actually have some truth attached to them, and that has shown that the discovery of Troy, the discovery of Agamemnon and Nestor's palaces, has shown that there's actually some atom of truth in those stories. It couldn't have all been lies. So, but the palace of Odysseus seems to be the only missing piece from the puzzle. And Jenny Costrin set out to look for this palace. She didn't actually set out with the mind to achieve this aim, you know. She did it because she wanted her husband was actually interested, who is actually Greek, Alex, was actually interested in Greek history and archaeology, and he wanted to discover the palace of Odysseus, you know, the same place where Penelope lived. I cannot forget that name, and you know, the event, it was a spectacular event. You know, she waiting for her long lost husband at sea, and using a tree to determine if he would come back or not. It's quite a fascinating story, you know, and tells a lot about the Greek culture. So, and that to discover that he moved to, he visited the Greek island often and on, and at the end of the day he bought a house and decided to live on that island. He would come and go for holidays, and at the time they moved there, but Alec did not was unable to discover the palace as he had wanted to. He died before that dream was achieved. But the wife, Jane Cochrane, who was much younger than her husband, took up the cause and decided to follow it up to the end. And at the end of the day, she actually, based on evidences from the Homer's epic, she was able to discover the location of the palace, or where it is believed to have existed at in the ancient time before the modern era. So, and with that, she was actually trying to counter the claim that an island close to that place may have been the place where the where Odysseus' palace is, on another island. I don't really remember the name, Kephasin or something. So that is the island she believed. The people believe there's some group of archaeologists wrote that the Odysseus palace may have been situated, but she countered that claim based on evidences from Homer's epic, located the scenes where so many scenes that Homer's described in his epic poem, the mountains, the landscape area, how it looked like. And what she is actually trying to tell us is that Ithaca, the modern day Ithaca, was still the old Ithaca where Odysseus lived as a king of that island and other neighboring island that surround Ithaca. So we are able to see that it's quite a remarkable experience, journeying through the work. But I think the first half of the work is majorly a memoir, while the second deals with the archaeological aspect. That is when we delve into, we go on exploration to search for the Chios Island. In the first aspect, she told us about the Greek culture, all their experiences with them, and how perhaps very little has changed since the time of Odysseus. So we get to see all these in action from what from the events that occur in the work. We get to see the Greek people, how certain ways of manners of speaking and ways of doing things has not changed a bit since the days of Odysseus. And also at the second part, we come to see how the palace was discovered, the evidences that are available to ascertain, to back up a claim. So that is what, those are the things that the book look at. It's quite an interesting journey, and it will make you feel like you're visiting Ithaca, to visit the place and see how the island really looks like yourself. I think she denied us of pictures. I would have loved to see pictures of the place added to the book, you know, in colored even, to see with my own eyes. Even though I may not be able to make the trip, at least with the pictures, it should suffice. You know, when she was describing the mountains and everything, words became useless. They could not capture the feeling or what I would have felt if I had seen them in pictorial representation. So I believe it's not too late. Something can be done to add pictures to the story at every point in time, instead of the drawings that was seen there. I would prefer pictures. So, and I think it's quite an interesting book. It's something, it's a book I would love to peruse again to see how the highland, how the place relates with how the place relates with Odysseus's palace. So it's something to go by. If you read it. Anyhow, I think the book talks about a woman's love for her husband. It shows that she was ready to carry on the course from where the husband stopped. You know, she believed in her husband's cause, and at the initial stage, she told us of the wonderful times and memories she has of him and events that played out in their lives. So it's a story of it. It talks about, it's a memoir that looks at the issue of love for a spouse, and also the need to carry on the course where Alec stopped. So it's quite interesting if you look at it that way. And I think the first part is more fulfilling to her as a writer than to us as the reader, because we are majorly fixated on the discovery of the island, of the palace, and how it was discovered. But she also wanted to tell us about the memories and wonderful moments she had with Alec. So I think it is quite fulfilling for her. And that is what writing should be about. The writer should feel fulfilled, not answering the call of the audience, or what the audience believe should be the perfect thing. If I want to write, for instance, I want something I could read and be happy with myself that I have written this, not because someone out there feels this is the right thing that needs to be written, or this is how this should be. So, and that's why you can hardly say the book is an archaeological book or a memoir. It is a medley of both. It is neither, but it is a combination of both. And this novelty in style, this merging of different genre is not too bad. It's not too bad. I loved reading about the relationship between herself and her husband, and also I like the fact that she was able to carry on from where her husband stopped. So I think it's a book you should also read if you're interested in Greek literature like I am and wanted to know more about the ancient Greco-Roman world. So thank you. That's all for today.